T-Doc again.
Yeah, son. Tuesday night. Time to change the style. What's up, everybody? It's C-Doc again. And we are live and direct, as always. I don't know what I'm saying, by the way, because 9 o'clock crept up and I wasn't ready to start the show. So, here we go. The show has started. So, instead of me blathering on like a moron, I'm going to, you know, bring on my co-host. So, ladies and gentlemen, as always, the wonderful and fancy nail-less Jennifer O'Jenny.
What's up, what's up, what's up?
Au naturel with the nails. Yep, there it is.
It, you know, it has to happen.
Sometimes. Sometimes it does. Sometimes you got to.
Exactly.
Yep. Change the style. The name of the song, Change the Style. Very apropos for this.
Right?
Yep. DJ M-Rock stuck at work again, and he, you know, loves his job. So we're filling the gaps with the one, the only, Flatline.
Flatline.
Welcome back to the show.
I wasn't ready for this either. I haven't even got a drink yet. I need a drink.
Okay, well, you got time because we're just kind of talking like idiots. The wife wants to know if you're okay, Jen.
I'm fine, Mara. I'm fine.
Yeah, what's
good.
Up with no nails? I don't understand.
There was damage. There was collateral damage.
I see. Okay. All right. I'll be back in 1 minute.
Okay, Flatline's gonna grab a drink. Jennifer, how are you?
I'm, you know, besides the fact that it's hotter than I don't know what here.
Here too.
I'm good. As are my cohorts.
Yes, gotta show them off. There you go.
She looks a little bit like roadkill right now.
Thankfully, she's not. So
puppy pancake, yeah.
Yep, there you go. Saw Mara at a McDonald's drive-thru 10 minutes ago. Oh, okay. That's funny. I just saw her upstairs. It's her evil twin. Hey, Vashon's in the house. He gets swivvy on the wheels. That's right.
Hey.
Yeah. Hey, Jennifer.
Hey.
I forgot to grab it. I forgot to grab the damn album. Oops.
What are we grabbing?
What is the today's anniversary? Do you know?
That would be 34 years of In Full Gear.
34 years.
Incredible.
Yep, there it is.
Mm-hmm.
Bring
it up.
Yeah.
Yep. 34 years.
34 years. That's crazy.
Classic material.
Classic material. That was one of the Chris, I've told the story before, but Christmas 88, and I got like just this. All I asked for was rap tapes.
Yeah,
I was just like, that's not, my mom's like, what do you want? I'm like, tapes. She goes, well, give me a list. I'm just list of tapes, and I just got, you know, it was 88, man. It was like the dopest collection of tapes ever. And right. In Full Gear, I was late
that
to the party.
That was one of them.
Yeah, but that was one of them.
Yeah.
Not late to the party. 88 Christmas.
Well, yeah, I know, but like this, if you know, this came out June 21st. I didn't get it till Christmas.
It was six months later. But
yeah,
nice. You still got it.
I did.
Yep. 34 years.
34 years. What did you get for Christmas in 1988, Flatline? Because I'm sure you remember.
1988. Oh man. Probably like I don't know. I want to say Transformers, but that might be a little late.
Yeah.
Wow.
I don't think it was music related though. Like my parents were not buying me hip hop stuff.
Yeah.
Not at all.
you know the best was my mom was going to the mall. She's like, "You want me to," and for some reason I wasn't. I don't remember why, but she's like, "You want me to get you anything?" I'm like, "Yeah, there's a couple of tapes I want to get. Can you get me Great Adventures of Slick Rick and NWA Straight Out of Compton?" And she's like, "Yeah, sure." You know, and then I went to bed, and then the next morning I woke up and there were these tapes sitting on the table. I had to sneak up and put the headphones on, you know.
Is it from Santa? Did they say
No, it was Santa? Like, no, she was just going to the mall. It was just a weird like thing. You know, it was kind of strange, but I remember sitting in my room with the headphones on, you know, and Fuck the Police comes on, and I'm just like, "Oh my God, I can't believe this is a song." You know.
Yeah.
So.
And my mother bought it for me.
And my mother bought it, and she can never know that she was responsible for buying this tape.
I'm the kid where my dad made me found Straight Outta Compton and Easy Does It in my room and made me destroy it in front of him.
No!
That's the household that I'm coming from.
No!
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
No!
Yeah, but yeah. You know...
Brutal. What would your mother think of this?
I know. Vashon's mom bought him NWA too. However, Vashon, your mom is infinitely cooler because she was on Soul Train and my mom was not. So.
Right? Right. Yeah. I was going to say that kind of goes without saying, Vashon.
I mean, I love my mom and all, but my mom wasn't. Mom, I love you, but you weren't on Soul Train. So.
You know, the crazy thing, Flatline.
Yeah.
I'm a preacher's kid.
Oh, yeah.
And a lot of these people were calling my house and speaking to my dad, the preacher.
Wow.
Had no clue. Had right. No clue.
Nope.
That's so awesome.
Yeah, it is.
Just like, I think I've told this probably a million times, but my dad's favorite show was SVU.
Mm-hmm.
And he.
Oh, yeah, that's right. You did. Yeah.
You know. That iced tea person, that's his name, right? Yeah, Dad, that's his name. He says, now somebody used to call the house, the one that you never could, ice cube, ice cream, yeah, Dad, that's him.
Yeah.
Had no clue.
Iced tea never called my house, but that's cool. That's all right. You got us beat there, Jen.
True.
You know.
Yep. True indeed.
I could write a book about all the times he'd say, "Let me see those headphones. Dad, you spoke to him on the phone."
And you should write a book.
No, I shouldn't. I really shouldn't.
You totally. So we can find out how you ended up at Africa Islam's house.
No, yeah. Right. No. Yeah. No.
There's some stories there for sure.
Yeah.
Yep.
Did you find the picture yet?
No. Why didn't you remind me?
I don't know. I was running the record label, I guess. I don't know. Damn it.
Ball sticks. I should write a book. Can I tell you how many times Tracy Morrow? Okay. Yeah. can I tell you if I had a nickel for every time somebody said, "You should write a book."
You'd have like 20 cents. Yeah, right.
No, I've heard that a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure. Well, we're all waiting, Jen. We're all waiting. Okay. Wisdom Beats in the house. Right. I can't wait to read it.
Let's all hold our breath.
Anyway, we've got a great show tonight, and I see our guest is in the waiting room, so we're just going to bring her on.
Yes, she is.
Because why the hell will we leave her sitting in the waiting room, you know?
Why?
Anyway, we're going to talk about, among other things, one of the all-time greats. If you don't know this album, you got to get this album. You got to find this album. Flatline's got it on cassette.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm trying to think if I have it on cassette.
Props.
I don't know, but here we go, Mara.
Yeah.
The testosterone yes. level is about to shift.
That's
Bring
right.
her on.
That's right. Ladies and gentlemen, from Son of Bazerk featuring No Self-Control.
Control.
HalfPint.
HalfPint.
Yeah.
How everybody
yes.
doing? Yes. How's everybody yes. doing?
Good.
Good.
Ah, so we
Thank
got the
you
feedback.
For having me, as always. It is so good to rock with fam all the time.
Do you have headphones?
Do you have headphones?
I have them, but I don't know if it'll work. Let me see if I put it in the...
Yeah, see if it does.
Yeah, see if it does.
Okay,
I don't want to have to listen to myself
all night.
Yeah. Mm. See if that helps.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Yep. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
There we go. Look at this.
Okay,
check this out. Professor Griff in the house.
Oh, Griff. Salute.
He's my brother.
Yeah. What's up, Professor? All right.
Salute, hip hop god.
Pint, you're
How's
everybody
doing?
Good. Oh, you got the Wall of Fame.
Right? Yeah. That's
incredible. Well, I'm in my office. I'm at home in my office, so I had to kind of decorate it a little bit, you know, put myself in my room, you
That's
know,
so.
Yeah, awesome. Awesome stuff.
Thank you.
Very cool.
Thank you. I'm trying to get like you guys and have that background that's fly.
Yeah, unfortunately, my...
I was going to say, wait a minute.
I got the printer. Jen has her
Flatline
sleeping
has
dog.
Flatline has the ice cube picture. You know. Listen, yep. It's flamed out.
Yeah, Flatline's winning this right now. Yeah.
HalfPint, before we start, I just want to thank you. You're always like saluting and like you're bigging up like hip hop gods and hip hop goddesses. I see it all the time on your posts that you do to people, and you kind of like keep the brand out there. So
yes,
thank
yes.
you. Yeah.
Yes. I mean, listen, when they coined it on that tour, I was in awe. So I have to continue to shout out those legends and pioneers that have been doing it and that are still doing it. Yep. So that this way we can spread the word to these young people. That's my goal.
Yep.
Well, you know what? That's a perfect segue. Let's talk about that tour, shall we? Let's talk about the Hip Hop Gods tour.
That tour was awesome. I loved it. I actually had took off work to do that. The first time I actually had taken off from work. And I just started I had just created a new program called Push, where I went down and I was getting some young people from the middle school to work and go to school from, I think it was 7:30 to 5:30 in the afternoon. So when I was on tour, I was actually still on the phone working with them every day. Even though my staff was holding it down, I still had to make sure that I was in the know. But that tour was awesome with some awesome people from Wise Intelligence, Brother Jay, and X Clan, Awesome Dre, the band, Johnny Juice, who is the producer extraordinaire, Moni Love. There was Public Enemy headlining and running it as if it was just like a review. I mean, what more can you say? Hip hop icons and gods and goddesses on stage, on tour, on buses together for 2 weeks straight, up and down the coast. Couldn't beat it.
That was
from the east to the west. I loved it. I enjoyed it. I didn't want it to end. And
it was 2012?
Yes, 2012. Yeah. 2012. I mean, to me, it was a major event because you actually saw us moving into the digital world. We had those cards where you can scan them with the soundtrack on it. Everybody had an individual card with the songs on it. The shows, the performances were just on point from day to day, night to night. And the camaraderie. I mean, this culture in itself is as small and tight as that. It's just tight-knit. And just the camaraderie when you're with artists who were, you know, who had an icon status versus, you know, cult classics and you know, Schoolie D, who's been in the game and doing this thing. And then he brought Doodlebug in from Diggable Planets. It was just a collaboration that I don't think has been topped since.
That's super. That's so dope, man. I remember when you guys were going around, I was actually busy. I missed it because I was actually busy shooting Swing Low, Sweet Chariot, which we'll talk about a little bit later.
One of my favorite movies and book and soundtrack. Yeah.
Yes. Thanks to you on that, on the soundtrack tip. So we'll talk about that. But but I did get to put together the documentary about it. That, you know, we're going to try to, I was actually talking to Chuck earlier tonight about trying to get it out again on the streaming platforms. So we're going to work on that so people can see at least a little taste of it. Yeah. Of what that tour was like.
Beautiful experience. It was a beautiful experience watching all of the artists perform in their element on a stage. And rocking with the crowd and the crowd rocking with them. And I think we were hitting like college towns at the time during the football and basketball season. So people were tearing themselves away from those activities to come and pack the houses at the places we were doing. It was awesome. I mean, it was a great experience. I mean, I had experiences being on the road prior, but this was a little different. This was us, you know, almost kind of not reinventing ourselves, but reintroducing ourselves to a whole nother group of people, but also reintroducing ourselves to those that may have forgotten about us.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
And shout out to Johnny Juice for that well thought out production, as well as the song that was on Hip Hop Gods tour CD called You're on the Verge of an Ass Whooping. So,
right.
Yeah. So dope. Yeah. And shout out to Johnny Juice because he really, I don't know, he kind of captured you in that moment, and you guys just put it down. That's a great project.
Thank you, appreciate it. Listen, he was able to recreate that that Bomb Squad magic, with us at a more mature age, but also with me even more rhyming than I was before, because I think on the first album you only really hear me on N41, and that in itself was a story because that kind of almost was an example of what I was trying to do in the group, trying to exert myself and listen, let me rhyme, let me get down. And and actually that song, when it ends, the reel actually ended.
Oh wow.
It was just like perfect timing. matter of fact, we were when we were thinking of the concept, the guys already had a kind of concept. So I was like, yo, we should do this. Like, let me do the intro like we're stepping into another world on the bus. Because just, you know, if you're a part of the hip hop culture, that being on a bus, the back of the bus, is essential to the history of hip hop. And so I wanted to take listeners onto a different realm and a different ride, reminding them like this is where that element comes from. And you know, you hear it throughout the song. I'm like, yo, can I get on the mic? Can I rhyme? And they're like, no. And then at the end, I kind of was like, you know what? I'm going to do it. I'm going to redo it. And they was like, yo, this is the last stop. And I had a whole much more to say, but they threw me off with that, yo, I'm out. Because TA was actually, Bazerk was actually starting to head for the door. And I just, you know, said, you know what? I'm going to kick this right here. And then as soon as I said, it's nothing but fretting, the reel ran out.
Wow.
It was like perfect time. So,
man.
Wow, that's dope. Yeah. I've heard the demo, you know, or the original tape that was from the BAU that they recorded up at BAU.
When they were the Townhouse 3.
Yep. And Chuck's on the Chucky D is on the original. Yeah.
Yep.
He's on that
and
version.
And they were the Townhouse 3 for a long time, in which they were actually making a name for themselves and around in Long Island. I was younger than they are, so I knew they used to always be at my house, at my mom's house. So I knew them and they knew my parents. So while they were coming up, I was still in the midst of, you know, being in the school beating on the tables in the back of the bus while they were now at, you know, radio stations and making the rounds and at shows performing with other icons that were coming to Long Island to, you know, to perform. So you heard about them, but I never got a chance to actually see them in action because I had to be in the house by dark. So wow. When the street light came on, I had to be in the house.
Yeah.
Those days. Yes. Mm-hmm. So how did you get involved with those guys and how did you become a member of the group?
Like I said, I knew them from when I was younger, but I actually was home going into my sophomore year of college. I played basketball in college. So I was home for the summer after my freshman year. My friends and I were, you know, we stayed at the park playing ball. We used to play basketball from 4 o'clock in the afternoon to 4 o'clock in the morning, straight playing like we were going to the NBA because the WNBA didn't even exist at that time. Mm-hmm. So right. we would just play all day long, all night long. And I happen to be, you know, I talk trash because, you know, that's what I do because I'm 5'3" and I'm playing against people that are like 6 feet. So I got to find some kind of edge to get them off their game. And I'm talking trash and I'm on the sideline talking trash. And somebody walks up to me and was like, "Yo, you sound like you could make records." And I'm like, "Yeah, all right, whatever, you know, because where did that happen at? Where did they do that at?" Right? So he's like, no, I'm serious. Like, you know, I produce the Bombs. I'm part of the Bombs Squad. I produce Public Enemy. I did Bill Big Bo. I did this, this, and that. And I'm like, yeah, I know Public Enemy. I don't, you know, because again, I'm right in Long Island. Flav used to be at my house and babysit and along with the rest of the fellas. So it's not like, again, I didn't know them. So, but I gave the guy my number. And he came to my house like the next day and he talked to my grandparents because I wasn't really of age. I was because I was in college. So he was like, "Yeah, you know, I'm putting this group together. I would like her to be in the group." And my grandparents asked me, "What do you want to do?" And I was like, "I'll try it. No, no big deal." The next thing I know, I'm at Green Street recording Change the Style with Hay Shockley, who happened to be the person that came up to me at the park.
Wow, that's crazy.
Yeah. And then I you know, the funny thing is that after we did Change the Style, we recorded it in Green Street, and we was there for like hours and hours and hours because Keith was meticulous and he's like a mad genius in the lab. So he just kept, it was this one part he just had to get right, and I think he was the only person that actually heard it because I was good after hour one. But after we recorded it, you know, the summer went on. I went back to school. And I'm like, I'm telling all my friends, "Yo, I made a record." They're like, "Yeah, right." I was like, "Really? I made a record." They was like, "What's the name?" I was like, "I don't know." They was like, "What's the name?"
"I don't know."
They was like, "What's the name?" "I don't know. I just know I did it." You know? Because you couldn't tell me before then that I wasn't going to be famous at something. Whether I was going to be in the NBA or I was going to be a recording star. I don't know. Either way. And then I, you know, the season went on, I'm playing ball, and I get a phone call before, it was a tournament, a weekend tournament, and they said, "Listen, you gotta come to, we gotta go to Chicago." And I'm like, "Chicago? I got a tournament. I'm a starter. I gotta make this game." But then again, I remembered I was suspended, so I said, "You know what? Let me call my grandmother. Listen, Grandma, I gotta go to the city. I'm going to be in the city, right, you know, for the weekend because I got to do a video." She's like, "All right." I was like, "Is the coach call for me? Just tell him I had a family emergency." Told the coach. He said, "You was coming in your, he was going to make me come in my street gear anyway." So that meant I wasn't playing. So I made the choice to hop on that plane. And actually, we ended up in Chicago with H-Gun doing the video for Change the Style. Wow. And came home. And it premiered, I think, I want to say it premiered with the guys at UMTV Raps. But I had class, so I just heard, all I heard was they were making fun of me because I was in class while they were on UMTV Raps. And the kids at the school, when I came down from class, they were like, "Yo, we were talking about you. You were on UMTV Raps, the video. We saw you." I was like, "Oh." Wow. I was like, "Wow." And then the rest is history. Yeah.
So
that's the crazy thing, because you were in there like right when, I mean, females weren't a big deal.
No, but they were actually, I think, still transforming the game because you had, you know, I listened to Sha Rock, Roxanne, Shante, Sparky D, Mercedes Ladies, you know, Pebbly Pooh, Debbie D, Wanda D. I loved hip hop, even, you know, when I had to sneak and listen to it because they didn't play it during the regular prime time radio. They would play it at, you know, at, you know, Mr. Magic's on his show. So those were things that I had to sneak in, but those were the things that were inspiring me. I mean, I dug the male MCs and I found my voice in hip hop, but just watching and knowing that there were other females that were out there doing it and doing it big, I knew it was something that I wanted to be a part of because I knew that this was something that spoke to me. And, you know, I want to say even like that, the summer before I actually, was the summer that we act before we even actually recorded, I actually ran into like MC Light and Latifah at a basketball game. It was an all-female basketball game. And actually all those players ended up being in the first year of the WNBA. So I'm in the midst of watching these players at the peak of their career, getting ready to transition to what they didn't know was existing or coming about, which was the WNBA. And here I am, you know, I'm meeting MC Light and Queen Latifah, and I'm able to walk up to them. And I was just, you know, letting them know how inspired I was by them. And the next thing you know, a year later, I'm on tour with them.
Wow.
So
crazy. Crazy.
Hey.
Yeah.
Pint, two things real quick. They want to know, who was the director of the Change the Style video?
H-Gun.
H-Gun.
From Chicago.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. From Chicago.
And then also, we have another special guest host in the house who just showed up, Mr. Chuck D.
Oh, shit.
Hey, my brother. What's good, Chuck?
Clapping for HalfPint, one of the greatest voices in hip-hop. Hell of a ball player. Hell of a ball player.
Yeah, man. I gotta start working out to get back there on the court. You know, it's been a while. I think people forgot, you know, what kind of damage I do on the court. So I'm gonna have to go out there and show these youngins.
you got a great looking corner there. You know, now everybody dresses their whole Zoom areas up now. But that corner right there looks majestic.
Right.
Thank you.
Right. Wow.
All due to being introduced to the 510 family and being able to, you know, etch a little space in hip hop for myself.
Your space is significant. What would you say today? Like, you know, we at Rap Station, we have an all woman, 24-hour, 7-day-a-week radio station. And part of the initiative for the second half of 2022 is to really just let everybody know that a station like this exists, playing the past, the present, and also the future. I mean, what are some of your takes on how to, you know, some of this could come about? How do we unite the woman hip hop nation? Because internationally, they're 33% of the game.
Wow. I just say, you know, like I was just saying earlier that hip hop, the culture in itself is tight knit and there's a camaraderie. And I think that one time I was talking to Glamorous, MC Glamorous, about the fact that having like a sister circle type thing where we actually get a chance to embrace and speak to each other on a different level, on a sisterhood level, but also, you know, in regards to hip hop and our roles and what we could be doing to bridge the gap between, you know, I mean, the youth and the elders in the game, said this way they understand and respect the culture. So as women at the forefront of any as a part of an intricate piece of any revolution, hip hop has definitely been one of them. I would definitely, you know, want to make sure that our young people understand the history of it and respect the role that women played in it because it has been very intricate. Absolutely. It definitely has been intricate, and it's been inspiring for me because I had role models to look up to as far as, you know, loving the game and being a part of that culture and how to conduct and move and how to, you know, how to even come up with the concepts that you want to in order to make sure that you get your point across and using it as a platform.
I'd like to thank you for also appearing in that Public Enemy video. You just, you know, made it happen. Shot by David C. Doc Snyder, and
yes, at
Roosevelt High, and that was just a dope day.
Well, thank you, and I thank you for making me a part of that, and then wanting to do it at the school, I think was dope because it was allowing our students to see, a bit of their own history from you being a part of it and coming back to the school. And then they also, it was my gift to them in a sense of saying, listen, we've been talking about hip hop. We've been talking about the history. You are part of the generation. Here's an opportunity for you to actually even, be a part of something that's bigger than all of us. And then for you and C-Doc to actually talk to the young people, that gave them inspiration as well. And, I'm humbled by every opportunity that I get when it comes to working in this field with young people, but also when it comes to hip hop. So I definitely appreciate all that you bring to the table and what you've allowed me to do and bring to the table with that song. So I appreciate that.
That was fun. That was fun.
It was fun.
Yeah, the kids loved it. My other students every year now, because I have to show them that. So the kids are like, when we getting down, Ms. J, what's up?
Well, it seems like it's crazy. Like today, as much as everybody is a screenager, it's a different time, and people are just not over like, oh my God, about seeing something on the screen, like, because it's every day, anytime, anybody. I mean, back in the day, if somebody was taking a picture of you, it was a big deal, much less like you was talking about H-Gun. And I remember that day too. I was like, because H-Gun, they shot the Anthrax video too. So in Chicago. So it was just that type of vibe where back in the day, when you're like, oh man, we're gonna shoot a video, with like a shooting a movie or whatever. But today, I mean, what could move a young person today? What moves them? Like, oh my God, can we get an oh my God out of young people except for some tragedy or catastrophe? Because, I think the world started to change a whole bunch of different ways, not for the better, but for the worse, when 9/11 happened and when people saw that in reality compared to before, where you would see it in like movies and special effects were coming up. But there's no special effects that ever could top that day of 9/11. And that's 21 years ago. So these young people have grown up and they look at a screen and now they got deep fakes and stuff like that. So what gets there, like, because you work with young people, man, what really makes them the most excited for the moment? Like, oh my God, because you've seen how young people used to be excited 30 years ago. But what does it for them now?
I think honesty, truth, and also relevance. How does it relate to them? A lot of times, right now the buzzword for education is cultural responsiveness, but that's really just teaching them about who they are, where they come from, and that knowledge itself that hip hop used to do. So, now they want to label it something else, cultural responsive, or they call it whole language, or they call it multiculturalism, whatever the case, whatever the buzzword that they give it. But the reality is that what it is that it's an opportunity for young people to really find knowledge itself, and then themselves within the confines of that curriculum. I always say right now, we're like at a tipping point in education, and either it is going to definitely crumble and it'll be living in the ashes for those that can't access the information, or we can rebuild our own curriculums and schools so that we can educate each other and empower each other. And I think for young people, this is a microwave generation, and they're stimulated from outside entities, whether it's TV, digital games, video games, or what have you. And they just need to get back to using their mind and their imagination and us cultivating those things. Being able to cultivate their imagination and their skills and their strengths, I think will make them excited, because now they'll see that they can create and they can do and they can become whatever they desire. It's just about making sure that we tap into those things and then show them how to build on that as we cultivate it. And then as we nurture it and give them you know, those options to say, okay, well, you know, you want to be in the medical field, but you don't have to be a doctor. There's so many other different positions that you can play. If you want to be an artist, you don't have to be in front of the mic. You can be this, this, and that. There's so many different other options. And I think when they see those things and they connect it to their strengths and what they love to do, it will make them excited. It will get them involved and it will get them engaged and keep them engaged.
Well said.
Are you able to use hip hop at school in your curriculum?
I do it sometimes innately because, you know, when you're part of the hip hop culture, it just happens. But what I have done is I have created, you know, curriculums pertaining to using hip hop. I created a sociology course called The History of Hip Hop from the sociology perspective, you know. I've also, you know, talked about and created curriculums that empower our young people through hip hop, with hip hop therapy, hip hop, you know, different entities that they'll be able to like really see them because they're a part of the culture. But again, if without the history, without the foundation, they don't know where they're going and they don't know how to get there. So at least I try to bridge those gaps and let them know before there was, you know, Travis Scott or Kendrick Lamar or J. Cole or whoever you listening to, there were these people. So listen to those lyrics, listen to what they're saying, understand what that journey was like. And then also know that again, we evolved from the African diaspora with those elements to become what we now know as, you know, breakdancing, graffiti, DJing, and MCing. Those elements were already connected to us. And then now, how do you now parlay that into something that's going to help you be able to express yourself, find your voice, and then, you know, find you in your peace in this, you know, this turmoil that we exist in and that trauma that we exist in? And how do you fight yourself out of that? How do you pull yourself out of that? How do you dig deep into your soul to find out who you are, where you're going?
Yeah. That's dope. That's really dope.
How old are the kids that you're teaching, HalfPint?
I teach high school, 9th through 12. Actually,
wow.
If I didn't piss too many people off, I'm probably assistant principal right now. Wow. They just were voting on that today to make me a probationary assistant principal.
Wow.
I was acting principal since last year. Assistant principal since last year, but I love the classroom because that's where you're in the trenches, you know. Mm-hmm. You're on the ground floor, really being able to have dialogue with young people and then see where their mindset is and then help cultivate that to where, again, they can now see options. They can now do better. They know better. And, you know, I was able to do that in the classroom and also still, you know, be an administrator in the alternative program later on in the day for those students who looked at non-traditional settings to support, you know, their academic journey. So we'll see what this year brings as the position I'm in now. And Lord help those who do not make our children a priority.
Yeah.
Right. Exactly.
Straight up. And now, when they misbehaved, you throw on Son of Bazerk records, the Bomb Squad shit.
I'm gonna try that as part of the restorative pieces that will come with our responses to intervention. I'm gonna try that. I'm gonna sit them in a room and just let them listen to me all day long. Just my voice. they always say that I'm yelling in the halls. I said I'm not yelling. I'm projecting my voice. See, when I'm yelling, you'll know. See, I have to be able to project so that you can hear me down the hallway while you're chilling over in the corner.
Yo, and you don't even have to project much because, I mean, it's cutting through regardless.
Yep.
You ever heard,
you're an MC.
I know. You ever heard Half Pint whisper?
Yeah, I don't know how to.
Exactly.
So imagine talking about somebody, they already know because I can't whisper with a lick.
Yeah, girl, I know. We were on tour once, you know. We had the Hip Hop Gods tour.
I was just telling them.
Yeah, we talked about that earlier before you came on.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I was actually still running my program from the bus, but, you know, like I said, I really love teaching, and it's a part of, I didn't even realize everything that I was doing with music and hip hop and in the group was able to be transferred over to the classroom. You know, being able to read my audience and engage them to make sure they understand and they're following with me. Because you have a lot of teachers who are great at content, but when it comes to facilitating, they don't know how to grab the crowd and keep their attention and keep them engaged. And that's one of the things that I've learned, you know, being on stage, how to keep the crowd engaged, how to keep them rocking with you so that this way y'all both are on a journey, but they're rocking with you so that you can get to your destination, which is the same thing that I try to convey in the classroom.
Wow.
That's so dope. Yeah. I love everything about that.
Yeah, that's great.
Thank you.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you.
Those connections and just planting those little seeds of knowledge and connecting with the kids is so important, especially at that age.
Yeah. Yes. And, you know, I got to say, I've always worked in pilot programs where I was able to kind of, I had the freedom and the trust of the administrators to allow me to do what I thought was in the best interest of the kids, which was always just authentically be me, but also give them some of the jewels that I wish that I had dropped on me, or the ones that I do know that were dropped on me, and give them that experience at the same time while opening their minds to opportunities that could be there for them, helping them live their dreams. And when I tell you that these young people have gone on to do some great things when others didn't believe they could, man, listen, I'm so proud of them each and every day, from the past to the present. My students really show up and show out and handle their business, and they beat the odds. They definitely beat the odds.
What's your cutoff point when you say, you know, like, what's the age cutoff where you say, I can't do nothing for you, man? I mean, you know, it's like after a while, you know, like, and you know, when they're teenagers, they're pliable. Even right. There's a little bit of area after they come back to you. But after, you know, you start looking at people 26, 27, even though they're young in our eyes and scope, but they in society where they kind of like, well, they're going to do what they want to do anyway. And right. So, you know, where's your cutoff where you say, listen, my priority is these 14-year-old kids, not your 26-year-old self?
I don't think I have a cutoff date. I think that's one of my issues. I have what you call the Napoleonic superwoman complex. So that means I think I could beat the world up and save it at the same time. And within that, one of the things, I don't have a cutoff date, but a cutoff time, but what I do know is that when there's a young person that I need to support, I have to kind of fall back until they're ready to receive that. You know what I mean? Sometimes there are students that may need my support, but they're just not ready. And if they're not ready, you know, I'll fall back and I'll let them know I'm here when you're ready. But they'll let them know straight up. Don't try to play me. Don't disrespect me, because you can get the business. but for the most part, you know, young people, you know, they're looking for support. They're looking for guidance. And I've been blessed enough to have students who, even if they were not ready, when they got ready, they knew where to find me. And then we just went from there. No judgment. Just saying, listen, you ready? All right. How about we do this? If, you know, if the high school diploma was a wash, then let's go look at this program for this GED. Let's look at this program that can help you for this. You know, these places are hiring. These things are hiring. Because my objective and my thoughts are to connect the school and the community, because we are in a village. And when one fails, the other one suffers. So we have to make sure that they're all given equity and opportunities to be successful. So, you know, I'd rather go to a store they own than one they're about to rob. So I got to make sure that I'm giving them every opportunity to be successful. And even when they buck the system and they're like, you know, they're not ready, you know, they will see me and they'll be like, you know, Miss J, you always help me out. I know I didn't, you know, really do what I was supposed to be doing, but I thank you and I appreciate you. And, you know, like I tell them, all I'm here to do is I'm just a vehicle to give you the opportunities. I'm just a catalyst. You know, you putting in the work, I'm just giving you the opportunity. So, you know, I want them to feel the same support that I felt coming up, because I'm definitely a child of the village. You know, I mean, I could have been an easy statistic, but there were people that were around me, that were surrounding me, whether it was good, bad, or indifferent, that helped influence my my you know, my goals and my dreams and my vision about what I wanted to do and what I didn't want to do. So when those opportunities presented themselves, I was, you know, prepared at some level to really embrace it and say, you know what, okay, I'm gonna rock with this because I don't want that over there because that's not going to do anything for me or that's not going to be beneficial. So I learned to, you know, decide and decipher what was going to be effective for me and what wasn't. And I don't even think I could articulate those things. I just think that I had those opportunities afforded me and given me so that I could jump on it and have some options. And I want to be able to provide those for young people as well. Basketball was the definite vehicle for me to be able to, you know, get to my goals, and music. Hip hop specifically, it saved my life in college because I didn't want to go to school to really learn. I wanted to go to school to play ball. So, you know, going to school was just something to do so I could play ball. But when, you know, and me being into hip hop, that kind of saved me in the piece of and helped me find my peace where I was at school because I didn't really want to be there. So, you know, those opportunities when they were given, I had to make sure that I capitalized on them. So I just want to give everybody else the opportunity to do so too.
You okay, Chuck? Are you still with us?
I'm verklempt.
You sound you're coughing up a lot, brother.
Yeah.
But you know what? If somebody needs to go and if you have kids that are the age that she's teaching, put them in her class because holy crap. I had a teacher, but in fifth grade, who was like that. And she didn't care what anybody, you know, what the curriculum was. She didn't care. She turned the classroom upside down. And this was her first year of teaching, and I don't know what happened to her after that. But every single person that came out of that classroom, one of the guys did makeup for Star Trek Next Generation. One of the guys, I mean, everybody went on to something huge, all because of her.
Wow.
All because of her.
You know, one person to believe in a young person and pass that love on to them. And I think that they can become anything and everything they choose to be. And, you know, that's what I want to be able to offer them through education and in the classroom. That's all. I mean, like I said, I love what I do, but I love even more the fact where I work at. I work in the Terror Dome. Right. Mm-hmm. You know, so listen, it doesn't get any better than working with young people and that I'm either related to or that I know their parents and then passing it down to their kids and their kids' kids.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm a do it until I can't do it anymore because that Napoleonic Superwoman syndrome comes in and kicks in. And I don't know how to take the cape off. So I'm learning how to take the cape off for like about 5 minutes, maybe.
My question is, you know, with all that to the side, all the rumors I've heard all throughout the years about HalfPint doing the HalfPint album. Is one out there? Is it one that we haven't caught hold to? Is there a bunch of people that you've also recorded with? I mean, where's that at?
Well, I would love to do an album. I did a single last year that was released during 2020 called Real Hip Hop.
Yeah, I played it. I think I played it. Yeah. Flatline also got it to me. Yeah.
Yes, and I salute y'all and I appreciate all the love and support. But I definitely am looking to work on a solo project. I would love to work with, you know, some sisters that are in the game that have been in the game for a long time, like Shy Rock, Glamorous, even doing, you know, a collab joint with several sisters and, you know, just meshing together the styles and the music so that we can show the camaraderie and sisterhood that, you know, that's evolved in hip hop. We are also working on a documentary for Son of Bazerk. We're starting, you know, we're in pre-production with some things, trying to tell our story, how we changed the style. I am, you know, outside of the music, I'm also, I'm a part of an organization called BU, organization, which is Black Ed Influences, where we're working to, you know, create curriculum and policies and advocate for young Black children and brown children to make sure that they get equity within the schools. I wrote some lessons, a curriculum actually, for Global 10 Black History, Black Studies for New York City schools with the Teachers College of Columbia. And they were reviewing it, so it should be coming out. The curriculum should be introduced and implemented sometime next year in New York City and then hopefully within the state. So, you know, I also have a consulting firm where I want to, at some point when I'm when there's really downtime, I can actually go into schools or go into communities and teach them how to really build curriculum that is reflective of the community and themselves. So that this way they are empowered, and no matter where they go from that point on, they have knowledge of self to start spreading and actually have their own voice and demand the things that they feel they should have in those communities and outside the communities. So yeah, listen, hip hop is my first love. So yeah, anything that I could do that involves that. I also, you know, I was producing a web show called The Classroom Hip Hop 101 with Dr. Blizzy, who's also known as the nation's hip hop principal. And, you know, Brother James, that's one Brother James, and Brother Miles, we were doing a Hip Hop for Justice
right
podcast, yep, which, you know, you frequent on and you're definitely a stakeholder in. So I'm trying to, you know, make those rounds.
And then you did the Pint and Ja, you and Ja Well.
Yes, the Pint and Ja show, definitely. We're trying to bring, hopefully we can be able to bring that back.
Because bring it back, I love please.
That.
Yeah,
I love so that with Ja Well.
Well, y'all was doing and, it with y'all was doing it when nobody was doing podcasts, yep, and things,
yep,
like that.
Yes, yes. Time. Yep. Absolutely, yep, absolutely. And
change the style again.
It was a great opportunity to really just, you know, sit and banter and have others watch how we interact. You know, because the guys are like my big brothers, so. You know, they always think that they're my boss first, but you know, again, I got that Napoleonic complex that kicks in and lets them know, nah, I'm in charge. So, but
when you guys were doing the Pint and Ja show, I was like, you guys got to do an album. I was trying to get that, you know.
Yes, I definitely want to, you know, in my project, make sure that. There's a cut with just me and Bazerk, and then also something with me and Ja.
You and Ja and Bazerk. That's you know what that would be? That would be Otis and Carla.
Yeah.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
Yes. And you know what's funny? Juice had us working on something like that.
Well, you could do Tramp all over again, because what Tramp was Salt and Pepper was like 30 years ago, so you right. could do yeah. Tramp again. I mean, the almost like in the original. Here I am on the show, Jenny Flatline and Doc always giving recording ideas, but we should keep it in the studio.
Well, listen, you know what's funny? Juice had us working on something like that at one point.
Well, Juice is never going to be a joke. That's why we're always trying to bring Juice to the forefront. Johnny Juice is no joke. You know, Gary G. Wiz is no joke. None of the Keith Shockley is no joke. None of the yep. cats is no joke. And I always try to bring people and say, you know, whatever relationships, you know, everybody has, it ain't all that deep. Because if you could do it, then do it and have right. fun doing it like you always had fun doing it.
Absolutely.
So that's, I mean, when you can't do it, when it's too late, like to me, like in my heart, I'm hurt that there will be no more Houdini records.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. It'll never and be I the was, same. No more.
And
no
I
more
was talking DM to all Bundy. Three of them. I was talking. Yes. All three of them came to my house, you know, and I said, "Look, you guys are going to be at each other's funeral, so why don't you just take advantage, you know, of this time right now?" And they just never could get on that next page. And now we no longer have Ecstasy. And I was even talking like, "Yo, X, I'll bring you in the studio." And we could record you, and then if Ja likes it, you know, which he probably yeah. won't, you know, but but I'm just like saying, like, even with me and Flavor, at least we did 2020. We did What You Gonna Do When the Grid Goes Down, you know, and you know your boy Rico. So, you know, to get him to actually yeah. do some work is you got to not only have a not only a fire under his ass, but you got to have like some kind of turbo nuclear reactor under his ass to get him to work. Somebody but you know,
the cane to just pull him along.
Yeah,
but, you know, like you said, life is short, and you know, it's really about making sure that you rekindle and reengage those relationships that you had, because I don't think anything's worth the separation or the non-communication
right.
among people who have been together for so long. You know, right. there's a certain bond I think people have when, especially when they've been together for so long, but definitely when they're on the road traveling and making music. I mean, when you are part of a project that actually creates, you know, a change in something, there's no going back from that. That means that right. relationship that you have keeps you bonded for life, no matter what. And yeah. I think I experienced that when, you know, when I went back to school and we stopped recording, I would still see them. And for a minute, I really wasn't, you know, I just wanted to concentrate on work. But right. I did miss, you know, I missed what I was doing in the music. I missed it. And, you know, sometimes my husband would find pieces of paper with rhymes all over the place or toilet tissue or whatever. He'd be like, listen, yo, you know, listen, you got paper over here. Can you put this somewhere? I don't want to throw it out. And then, you know, when I think it was, I did an interview on one of those blogs with Craig. His name was Craig Belcher. And it kind of reminded me of mm-hmm. just doing that interview, the love that I had for what we were doing, but also we made an impact. And then the camaraderie of being around them, even though, you know, like I said, they were like my big brother, so they could be pains in the butt, but I missed all of that. And then when Juice offered the opportunity to listen, I'll produce, you know, this next album.
That was great.
I jumped on it and I didn't hesitate. Yep. And I think the timing was right. I think the mood was right. I think I was in the right place. So it was the experience in itself put me back into what we was when we first came out. You know, but I was more mature and able to really embrace it the way that I wanted to and appreciate it. I mean, I was younger then. I just wanted to hang with my friends and play ball, you know, but the experience in itself taught me so much that I didn't even realize how much of that I carried over into, you know, my next journey with education. And now, and then to do Well Thought Out with Johnny Juice and come out and then go on the Hip Hop Gods tour, perform at Zulu, you know, the Zulu anniversaries, those kind of things put us back out there, but it also helped us make connections that, you know, were either missed from before when we first came out, or even just re-engage those things and reminded people. So I think I was able to really embrace it a lot more as, you know, as we got along. You know, but remember, I'm only 19, so just know that, you know. That.
Well, remember the press conferences we had before the concerts, and you really stepped up and really, you spoke. It was you, Moni. So we had, you know, female representation on the tour, and you let it be heard just in those pre-concert press conferences.
Yeah, and I really did appreciate it. I mean, you know, sometimes I can't shut up, so that's my reason why I was talking so much. But I really did appreciate it. And like I said before, the camaraderie, you have a way of making sure that everybody feels welcome. And, you know, when we were on the tour, when I was, you know, back in the days in 91, we were on that tour, you had this, it was the same thing. We were on tour with not just you, not just Public Enemy, but Naughty by Nature, Queen Latifah. These were people that were icons, that became icons and were at the top of their game that time. And nobody had egos. And even though we were opening act, everyone embraced us. And that said a lot about, you know, what you brought to the table and then how you were able to make sure that people were, you know, treated the same and treated equally. The respect and love that everybody had for each other. The fact that after the shows, everybody would stay for everybody's show. And then afterwards, we'd go out somewhere afterwards. And then to, you know, reignite that with the Hip Hop Gods tour and feel that same camaraderie and that same love. I mean, we were eating at the table with each other. We were hanging out. We were on the buses. So we slept in the same places.
Yeah.
Those type of things. I think when you hear about tours nowadays, it's not like that. It's, you know, the artist bus, and maybe even if they're in a group together, they will travel differently because of the mentality that they developed over the time, where they let that fame get to their heads. I think you have an even keel to where you make sure that everybody is on the same level. And I think that that's rare. And I definitely appreciate it. And I learned a lot from that and that camaraderie, because it was embracing to me that made me feel like maybe I did kind of do something. Maybe I am a big deal.
He was a big deal.
Especially in the midst of all the giants. So I definitely appreciate that love.
There's two words for that. Camp counselor is really... But you definitely know how that is, because you're a camp counselor and a teacher, so you got to make everybody feel special. And also, you got to recognize everybody's job that they bring to the table, and that's what you've done so well. And we're looking to do real big things at Rap Station and also Spit Slam with powerful people behind us, but really, you know, doing the art, but really teaching the art. And there's a lot of young people that want to get involved, but we're telling them, I said, listen, it's one way to do this, and there's 99 ways to do it wrong. So I think this is something that you should do and do for the rest of your life. I mean, you remember back in the day, you know, like, you know, Tretch was a young guy, and Tupac, although he wasn't on that tour that you was on the year before, those guys always remember those days as their best time ever, because they felt like they would have an extended teenage years on a, you know, on a camp. And that's how that's what you want to get across. You know, you would say this is the best time of your life. You might not be getting all the great money in your life, but this is the time you're going to remember for the rest of life. Right.
Yeah, just the experience itself. And like I said, I've learned so much. And even if those people don't remember me, like I said, the impact that it had on me and how it followed with me, and I was able to take a lot of those things that I've learned and use it and, you know, in this other journey with education, it's priceless. Like I tell, you know, I remember sitting at the side of the stage with Ice-T, and he showed me how to watch the crowd and how they connect each other and work with each other. And that was so profound, because again, that's what I use in the classroom, that connection, how to read my audience, how to read a room when I step in one, how to read the crowd. You know, I could clear a room in a second by saying some things that make people feel uncomfortable. So, you know, when it's done on purpose, is the calculated idea based upon some of those principles that I learned from Ice-T. And again, that all helped to, you know, create the ideals and the visions that I have when it comes to empowering young people, because hip hop helped do that for me. And everyone in that realm, they played a part in, you know, my development, whether it was for 5 seconds or 5 years or, you know, 30, 40, 50 years, or whatever the case may be, it had an indelible impact. So, you know, I definitely have learned and appreciated all those lessons coming up to even now. And I want to share that with those young people and let them know. I didn't think I would be on tour, but I did it. I mean, I when I was in high school, I was giving out autographs, telling people, like, yeah, I'm going to be famous. Yeah, I had photography, taking pictures. Yeah, I'm going to be famous. Take my autograph. I was so brazen. I think I gave Mark Jackson my autograph at the basketball camp I was at. I was like, yo, you know what? Here my autograph.
It must be the Freeport water, because I remember all the time, you know, Jawell and T.A., Bazerk and Almighty Jawell and y'all. Flavor would just, you know, he be answering the phone. They say, oh, this is Big Chance. This is Big Chance. You know what I'm saying? He said, look out, here go Rico's Big Chance. And he ended up being Flavor Flav getting his big chance. But, you know, special times. And this is why this format is great, because a lot of people don't think it's a possibility that you could say hip hop, great experiences, life lessons, you know, things that also go through the chapters of time that make somebody say, wow, that it's so enlightening, you know, and make some people say, oh, yo, I wish I was back then. And back then didn't mean it was easier. We just took advantage of what we could do and what was offered, you know. And today they have so many options to have a wonderful experience with the music. But
yes,
That nobody has come in and said and commanded the attention to say, this is the right way, and there's 99 ways to do it wrong and to make you mad and you go home saying it was the worst time ever. And I just think that you know, these type of shows, matter of fact, if y'all could make a little snippet of when Half Pint was talking to Ice-T and send it over to Ice-T. That's the advantages of what we do with this show, to say, yeah, these stories should be heard. You know, because I feel there's a million podcasts also out there saying and doing the same thing. But I think this is special.
Yeah, it definitely is. And I definitely appreciate it. I mean, again, just the camaraderie and the family oriented, you know, settings that, you know, that I think that you were able to support and help provide, that in itself says a lot. I mean, again, when you look at certain statuses, people in hip hop, they don't sit on a throne and look down. They are actually wanting to mingle with the people, want to interact, want to help build, want to help cut, you know, have those conversations and drop those jewels. And I think that that is going to be the caveat that is going to allow the young people to really be receptive to, you know, what is necessary for them to be able to preserve the culture and to build on it.
Yeah.
Excellent. Why do we need to put her in contact with Daddy-O? Why? Why is this like constantly running through my mind?
And you know, I don't even know if Daddy-O remembers, but I met him when we were at the New York the summit, right? Back in the summer, I think, of 90.
Oh,
90, no. 91. Yeah. And we were in the lobby somewhere. He was sitting down, and I was sitting down, and he was just dropping some jewels about the game. And I'm like, oh shoot, like I'm thinking in my head, like, I'm sitting next to Daddy-O. From Stets to Sonic. Go Stets. And my mind goes, go Stets. Again, you know, meeting these icons and then for them to just have conversations with me as if I'm a part of that world. I mean, it's reassuring, but it also it's something to be embraced. But also, I have those stories to talk about. And sometimes I don't even believe in myself.
Yeah, I think tell me about it.
People think I'm making stuff up.
Right? Well, don't you ever look back and go, "Holy crap, I was involved in that."
All the time,
and it kind of blows your mind, right?
Yes, all the time. See? Because I, like I said, sometimes I don't even believe it myself. And when I came back off tour and I went back to college, they did an interview and they was like, "Well, how did you feel?" I was like, "I don't know." Like, I think I was still in shock that I actually took off, went on tour, been overseas. You know, headlining overseas, back on these major tours with all these major acts, going across the country, and I don't think it really dawned on me just yet, like what I was actually doing.
Right. Right.
And then when I tell people or I say something, sometimes I wonder, like, am I telling the truth? Did that really happen? You know,
right.
I would have never, like I said, even though I thought in my head I was going to be famous, I never thought these things would actually occur. I didn't think they would occur through hip hop in that sense of being in a group and then touring and then meeting all the people that I respected in the culture and that I listened to their music. And then I, you know, and next thing I know, I'm at a show with them or I'm having conversations with them or performing on stage. Like those things I wouldn't have fathomed.
Yeah.
Well, and
they definitely were blessings.
Yeah, and the fact that you're a female makes it even bigger. And then, like, you add me. Hi, in case you didn't know, I'm not the same color. I was at Chuck. Weren't we? We were like the number one black radio station in the country.
Yeah, exactly. You're talking about Kayden?
And I look, yeah. And I look back on it and I go, holy crap, I was there.
Yeah.
Right. Part of history and not really realizing it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. You're
and
just
even if I was just in the corner. Right. And sometimes I feel like I was in the corner of watching everything happen, but I was there. And that experience, like I said, it continues to follow me. And I think about some of the things. I'm like, wow, like I really was I really was on tour with these people. Right, you know, I was there when Leaders of the New School and Tribe Called Quest first performed Scenario live, you know, on stage. I was there when, you know, when it was freezing outside. Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince were talking about warming up with Summertime.
Yeah.
You know?
It's weird. It's a really, it's an out-of-body experience. It's really bizarre.
Yes. Yes. But
what were we just talking about? Having to tell my father, who was a minister, that the person he was watching on SVU was the same person that used to call the house and he never could get his name right.
Right.
Person whose name was on my headphones, he knew exactly who that was. You know. but it's such a bizarre out of body experience to go, crap, I was there.
Yeah, I think one time when we was on tour, because I would always call my grandmother anytime at like late hours of the night after the shows and stuff like that, because, you know, she'd still be up. And I want to say, I actually put Latifah on the phone to say hi to my grandmother. So I was like, say hi to my grandmother. Hey, baby, how you doing? You know? Yeah. I was good for that. Listen, speak to my grandmother. Say hi to my grandmother. And she, you know, she listened music to hip hop vicariously while I was listening to it. So her and my grandfather would hear it from me playing it in the basement, blasting it, you know, loud. But my house was always filled with some kind of music, whether it was my grandfather playing an organ or my grandmother playing a, you know, the Casey Kasem, you know, 25, what is it? The top 20.
Top 20, top 40. You
know, top 40.
Casey Kasem, top 40, 1975. Yeah. Number one hit. Yeah.
And when it used to come on Saturdays, on TV on Saturdays, because, you know, like I said, I had to be in the house by dark. So I would watch the cartoons, watch Soul Train, watch the karate flicks, go outside for a little bit, acted out the karate flicks I just saw. And when the street light came on, I had to come home. So when I was in the house, I was watching, you know, the variety show with Barbara Mandrell and the Mandrell sisters, Liza and Goldie, the Osmonds. And so the people, you know, I talk to my friends, and sometimes, you know, I think in my mind, I hear the music, I might pop out into some of the stuff. They be like, what do you do? I'm like, this is what happens when you have to be in the house by dark. You have a vivid imagination and you remember all those shows and all those things that help cultivate your music background.
I'm telling you, imagination is everything.
Yes,
and,
it is.
Today they make sure that young people don't use or build an imagination. They make them go out and purchase an imagination out there. So this is the difference before, you know, the difference between back then and now. So, you know, that's something that what you said is really major. That I don't know how that's going to happen, how that's going to get back into cultural education, but you got to have young people be able to explore their own imagination, because if they don't, they'll be doomed to just be a consumer.
Absolutely. I tell my kids all the time, you'll never know the struggle of having to use encyclopedias and carry it from one aisle to the table to actually research your paper. You can ask Siri, Alexa, Cortona, whoever you want for any answer without you having to think about anything. Even when you use the calculator, it does the calculations. So I try to make sure that I engage their minds with thought-provoking things. Like, you know, just as simple things, though, too. I you know, those string, remember the string, the twine that you make the string? And I'm like, listen, I'm like, what is this? They were like, Mr. J, that's some string. I'm like, no, this is a game, boo. You can play it.
Right.
Said, listen, and you play it all day long. And if your friend come, they can join in too. I said, that's math, that's physics, that's science. I said, and it's imagination. I said, and our generation created all of the privileges and all the things that you use now. My concern with you guys is, what are you going to produce next? Yeah. Because everything is already, all that thinking is done for you. And if you don't learn how to think for yourself, you right. will be controlled by the entities that want to continue to program you.
Yep. That's true.
And I call it the three P's: propaganda, programming, and policing.
Yeah.
So, you Word know, we have to make sure that they are awake and they are aware. And I think one of the things that really kind of opened up some things for them and kind of sheltered places that they live in, their mindset as far as being sheltered, the confines that parents provide and protection around them. 2019 and 2020 with the pandemic, mm-hmm. and then what we saw with the civil unrest. They actually experienced that firsthand, and a lot of them joined those marches. They became involved. They became, you know, advocates with voices. And now those are other things that we need to cultivate to support them so that they understand that the vehicle could be used, hip hop could be used to help them find their voice. And be, like you said, it's the voice of the voiceless, the CNN of the, you know, the CNN of the ghetto, all those things. And I try to remind them of that, so that this way they know that they're important and that they matter, and that they have to, you know, they have to make sure that they are demanding the equity that they deserve.
Yeah, when I saw like rallies in Merrick, Long Island,
yes,
I said this is a different thing. And like I said, hip hop is a great start, and that had a conversation in it. So it's a good thing to pick up on. So yeah, thank you for all that you're able to deliver in real life, and also in recording and music and cultural things that you've done.
I appreciate that. Thank you. Because like I said, I just wanted to be able to create my own lane, because I love hip hop, but I love the artists. I love the people that are within that culture and the camaraderie. And I'm just still trying to just, you know, stay in my lane and make sure that, you know, I can bring something to the table that is going to be fruitful and that's going to support the culture to continue to preserve it.
I don't know, Chuck. Hip Hop Gods Tour, part two.
Listen, sign me up.
I'm telling you, I mean, it's a blueprint that's definitely there. C-Doc tied up the documentary. It's something we want to get out there, because we feel that those short tours, 12, 14 days, nothing longer than that. Everybody mm-hmm. travel together, you know, eat the same, you know, restaurant, stay at the same hotels, travel to two buses. It could be economical, and it worked like a review. Everybody needs to know that after every act got off, well, I brought on every act, and I interviewed every act after they got off, and I had to close it down at the end of performing and all. But great help from every single act, because they held it. They did it. Johnny Juice as being the Johnny Juice was more like the, what do you call it, the music director, conductor, director, yeah. Of it
the
all.
Maestro. And,
it was something to be looked at as a blueprint and to follow up. But once again, it would have been impossible if a person like yourself didn't hold it down and do such a great job on stage in the time that you had. So that's, you know, it's a blueprint to follow, but you got to also follow the professionalism of the groups as well.
Yeah. And like I said, that was an experience. And I really love being on stage. I think I love being on stage more than recording. Yeah. It's a little different. When you record it, I think I actually hear myself, and it's a little different. I don't know why y'all think my voice is a little higher, but I think I have a deep voice.
you have a cutting voice. A cutting voice. It's a difference.
Yep. It cuts through.
It cuts through. Yep.
And so, but being on stage is a whole different kind of experience. It's almost spiritual. And I love it, because I love the connection with the people. I love the connection and how the music kind of just takes over, and it just allows you to just be free. And that's what it's like being on stage for me, the freedom of being able to just express myself and then connecting with my audience. And it's all, like I said, it becomes spiritual and ritualistic for me. And I love it. I really do.
Flatline, I know you had a question, and I want to hear what that question is. Because he didn't have any questions last week, but he told me he had a question this week. So let's go, bro.
Well, all right, all right. So I'm curious, just half pint from your like perspective. So you were talking about like Latifa and MC Light before, and then it shifted. And I'm not like there's no shade involved or anything, but it went to like Foxy Brown and Lil' Kim, and I love them, but apart from men running the industry, how do you think that all went down? Do you? It's a little strange to me. I was thinking about it, and I thought that'd be a good question for you.
For me, I think it became more about supply and demand, mm-hmm. creating a lane that kind of capitalized on, you know, a different outlook and a different perspective of females in hip hop. And then it became something that just was like, okay, this is okay. I like the music. I like the way that the sound goes. And then the content became something that was more adult, but I think that the audience wanted it. So they gave them what they asked for, and it just continued mm-hmm. to grow in that situation. And I think that as we became more, as that music became more commercial, it became more popular. They moved away from the variety and the balance of females and their opportunities to express themselves.
Well, my question is this: on top of that, it's like, okay, when do we start paying attention to the fragmentization of the music, knowing that you got hip hop that really it ain't for no 14-year-old. But we got hip hop that's for a 38, 41, 51 year old person, and it's over here. And then you got stuff that, you know, but I don't think there's, I mean, you know, I'll be playing like Kids Bop on Channel 78, you know, on Sirius, and it's clearly for kids, you know.
Right.
But I don't think you could throw all of hip hop in the same sandbox and say it's a music of the youth. Yeah. So
right,
it's all over the place and not compartmentalized correctly. It ain't curated, and it's just like we'll throw everything hip hop at people, and wherever it lands. And I'm like, you know, right now, where if it doesn't control a narrative in that particular space, it ain't gonna be around in any case because it's gonna turn. It's not there for everybody, you know. I don't make music for a kid. And I don't make music for the ghetto. I ain't from the ghetto. I ain't from the streets. So my music, my point of view is going to be like, yo, and I'm not, you know what? I ain't looking for that. Now, if that audience comes and finds some jewels, fine. But I never really, you know, was into making music for a 12-year-old anyway, ever. But, you know, you're in the middle of that stream and you're like, okay, so there's what we talk about in hip hop gods. When we're talking about like even in classic hip hop or the realm, you know, what we're trying to do is like, you know what, we're gonna have to like shut the door at 40. And anybody under 40, if you could swim up to that level, you'll find that it's for you. Underneath 40, you're gonna have to learn how to swim. Right. It ain't gonna be there if you're 25 and under, yo, we ain't got nothing for you, man, at all. But there is something in the dynamic of it, but it ain't never gonna be pointed at you. And I just think that what they're doing at Rock the Bells and LL, I think they finally understood that they have to close the door on some things and say, you know, we not that. We this, we not that. And that's something that we want to also take advantage of as well. Because I don't think, seriously, like when that time came with Foxy and whatever, that was grown folk rap.
Music, so right? Grown absolutely. Folk
music, and it's a whole different thing. And so, but at the same time, it's going to be on the radio. It's going to be promoted. So really, right there and then, you're just saying that this music ain't for the youth.
Mm-hmm. Right. I think it's about access. Because like you said, that was grown folk content, but it was pitched and targeted to young people. Because you said it best when you said that hip-hop artists, as they get older, are not as revered as they would have been if it was classic rock or any other kind of genre of music. Right. So when you look at that and you look at, you know, what they're trying to do and how they're trying to manipulate hip hop as a whole, you see that they're targeting the young who don't have a connection to the history. So they can tell them anything and say, yo, this is hot. So this is what right. you should like. And then right. they'll start looking at that saying, you know what? Yeah, this is what I'm this is my message. This is my music. Because everyone, when you look at the hierarchy of Maslow, it's all about, you know, at the level of belonging. So everybody wants to belong to something. Everybody wants to have something of their own. So when you are able to divide and say, you know what, this is going to be for, you know, this group, this is going to be for that group. And you know that what's for one group is not really empowering them, but detrimental because of how it's packaged and how it is romanticized when they're really trying to give you some jewels. It becomes now an appeal that they have to separate from the elders because, you know, we've been there, done that. So we're looking at that like, you don't have to go back to that route. We've been there, yeah. done that. Kind of like what the elders were telling us when we were growing up. You don't have to do this because I've already put in the sacrifice. I need you to do something different. I need you to move forward. I need you to look at and preserve what has already been created and then create your own. Jump off the shoulders of these elders and these ancestors. And I think that hadn't happened when you look at the change and the dynamic of what commercialism has done to hip hop and how it has tainted it in the sense of it's a difference between being a rapper and then being a part of the hip hop culture. And I think that even though you're a part of the hip hop generation, again, without that foundation, without that information, without that connection, you're easily, you know, swayed to kind of do some things that you would not do if you knew better. Like if you know better, you do better. So I think it's purposely done in that sense because you've always called it a core plantation. So, and that's exactly what it becomes, the new plantation to sow those seeds of young people and have them so distracted that they're not focused on what hip hop was really supposed to be doing and the catalyst of what it was and the voice that it was. And I'm not saying that there's not a, you know, there's not an audience for those things, but when you don't have provide that balance, it becomes now an issue because now they think that this is all that there is to it. There's so much more. We're multifaceted. We're not one dimensional. And I think that that's what we see today because that's how commercial and how the corporations have now played it out that, you know, when you get a certain age, you no longer are relevant, but you are. You are mature and you now have more jewels and experience to pass on. But with the young people, by, you know, separating them and closing them in to the point where they don't have those options or they don't see that. But now the good thing is that you do have Rock the Bells, you do have Hip Hop Gods, you have all of these, you know, these radio stations that are streaming, that are playing classic hip hop. And then also playing the music that they are making now to let them know it didn't go nowhere. We didn't go nowhere. Yep. Right. Come on, how many albums you put out, Chuck, since you started? You didn't go nowhere. You ain't going nowhere. You still are that voice, and people can access you because you have now those platforms. And it is content that they will need, and they will seek it out once they get rid of those distractions that cause them to realize that, yeah, I can talk to my young people, but I also got to start feeding my soul so that this way I grow. I shouldn't be making the same album, you know, that I made in 2019, make that same album, the same thing in 2021. I should have grown, you know what I mean? Right. So that's about mobility. That's about access. And that's about, again, you know, changing the programming and the propaganda that exists so that they will stop policing us and dictating our narrative where we can control that.
Mm. Half pint for president.
Yes. Well said.
Very well said.
Yes. Very Man. Well said. Right? I know. I need a moment to just kind of soak.
I know, up. Right? Yeah.
Wow. Sometimes that could be deep.
Well, there's a lot of podcasts going on right now, but I'm telling you, like what's just been said in the name of hip hop on this particular cast is what everybody needs to know that this is that extra level.
You know? Absolutely. Right.
Indeed.
Combat Jack used to do that very well. It's done here. And earlier this week, Peter Rosenberg said that he invented the hip hop podcast. So, you know, I let him on that. We had one go. We had one round going in on each other years ago that I didn't even want, you know, and everybody else kind of like stepped up to the plate and all that. So I kind of let Rosenberg, you know, own some things. But, you know, you can't invent anything when the technology's ready for you to make it. You know what I'm saying? Right. Apple made the iPod, so therefore you had the podcast, because Apple made the podcast, so they wanted their own communication network of podcasting through the Apple system. So they already designed it. So all you got to do is say, well, whether it's classical or whether it's hip-hop, you came in there and used the system they designed. So
you
could claim it, but, you know, that's like claiming that, you know, that's like naming a lake.
That's like claiming America, right?
Yeah, right. I'm gonna name that mountain that's just been there a billion years, but I'm gonna name it. I'm only under 100, but I'm gonna name that mountain a billion year old mountain, and I'm gonna claim it. It's gonna be my mountain and my river.
Now, you know, better yet, I'm gonna claim your house, and then I'm just gonna come in there. I'm gonna park myself, bring everything I own, and just claim it right there.
Exactly.
I'm just claiming it.
Right. So I left the shade alone. No shade. I throw no shade.
They'll get over it.
I just thought it was funny. Yeah. Well, so I got some other things to do, but I'm gonna salute and be out and catch the rest of the show on the screen. That's why you see me looking, because I'm watching the screen. I'm talking to y'all, so I'm a little cockeyed. But I'm salute the rest of the crew. Wonderful show. I'm glad I could participate. Keep doing your thing, Pint, and I'll be looking for those new records, those new albums and videos, and also the Son of Bazerk documentary.
Absolutely. Anytime you need me, you know I'm a phone call away, brother. Anytime.
Yes, ma'am. All right. Peace, y'all.
Thanks, Mr. Chuck.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
So before we wrap up, Pint, what's next for Son of Bazerk?
The documentary, we are going to do a couple of songs for like a soundtrack.
Nice.
And, you know, again, hopefully I'll be able to, I've done some features that I want, you know, Donald D, my big brother, the B-Boys. Yeah. They asked me to be on. Listen, and please know, anybody that asks me to do a song with them, I'm humbled by it. Because again, I still got to remind myself that I'm HalfPint, you know, right. And that I had something to do, or I had a little piece of hip hop, mm-hmm. you know, etched in my history. But you know, when he asked me, he texted me, was like, "Hey sis, would you like to do a song?" I was like, "What? Yes, like." You want me, just like even when you asked me, see, like I was humbled and I was surprised, like, you sure you want me on the phone? Yeah. And I don't want people to think that, you know, when they ask me, like, I'm trying to say, like, I'm better. No, I'm just, again, I'm still in awe of the fact that they would think I could bring something to the table, and that they would want me to be, you know, a part of their project. And, you know, when Donald D asked me, I was like, no question, yes, like, send it to me. I got you. And I did it, sent it back. I think I must have did it in like maybe a couple of days turnover, send it back to him. I heard it and I'm like, wow, like this is classic hip hop. This, you know, these are icons and they asked me to be a part of it. And, you know, even when, you know, when people ask me, I love hip hop. So if the message is right, if the music is right, but you know, yes, I'm gonna do what I do, if it feels right, because I love it and I want to make sure that people understand and can feel the love and respect and the respect that comes with that, so that this way they know what they need to do, respect and love and preserve the culture.
Yeah, remind me, because it's been 10 years. It'll be 10 years when I think I asked you to do the song. Did I ask you to do the song? How did that? I don't remember how it happened.
You said you can't. We were at Chuck's house, and you were like, HalfPint, I got a question to ask you. And I was like, okay. So like, you think you want to be on a soundtrack? I was like, yeah, like. Like, duh, like, are you asking me? Like, I don't think you remember how dope you are as a producer. Hello, Sea Dog. Yes. I would love to. Absolutely.
That's right. I totally forgot we were at Chuck's house because we were shooting something.
Yes. And as soon as you told me about the movie you were doing, I ordered the book. I read the book.
That's what it was.
I love the book so much. I went and bought copies and gave them out to my students.
Yeah, like, I remember.
Listen, you got to read this book. This book is crazy. It is dope. And then when you did the film and it came out, I was giving the movie out as gifts as well. Like, listen, this movie, you have to watch it. I talk about, because I love your contribution with Impossibles and what you bring to the table. You're like the first internet hip hop group. Like,
yeah.
Come on, that's epic. Yeah. And remember how we met? Through YouTube, because I posted some music that we had that wasn't released.
Yes.
And I think and you contacted, you was like, hey, where did you get that from? I was like, it's me and my group. You said, you're Son Of Bazerk. I was like, yes. Oh, I was like, oh my goodness, like
yep.
That's you were right, a brother after that. You were my big brother after that. I just want you to know. And then, I like to gather big brothers because I just think that, you know, being a little sister is the dopest thing. So when I call you, if I call you a big brother, Flatline, if I call you Sister Jennifer O. Jenny, know girl. That it is with the utmost respect and love because, again, that's what hip hop has done for me is giving me that love, that camaraderie. And embrace me. So I want to be able to show that love and that embracement from that I've received. So, you know, listen, I'm just waiting for you to say, Pine, I got another track for you. Well, I need you to be on this feature. Like I told you before, listen.
Daddy-o, hello. D-Doc, daddy-o.
Yes, we will.
Listen,
we
I would love it. I would love it. I wish I was on that self-destruction part two.
That's well, what, we ain't done yet.
It's not done. It's not even close to done.
Yep. They ain't done yet.
Well, listen, if you need another verse, just let me know. Listen, in my mind, I'm on self-destruction one, okay? Just in my mind. Just want someone to know, okay?
That's what's up.
Just in my mind.
You could do that. So am I, girl. Whatever.
Jenny's on. We're all in the same game.
My students actually do a remake of self-destruction.
What'd you say, Pike?
I said I actually, 1 year, I had my students actually do a remake of self-destruction.
Wow.
Using we used the Superwoman beat by Little Mo. And we did it. I had to do it the poor man's way because, you know, I had a karaoke machine with a tape deck, a double tape deck, one side of the tape, and the other side with the blank CD. Blank tape. And then I told the kids, listen, do your verse, and we're gonna pause it when you finish. We're gonna pause it so the next person could go. And then they wanted to do a video, so we, you know, went to the by the park. I had them do the whole thing. It was rough, but they loved the opportunity to actually be able to express themselves. And I showed them through when we're teaching English, how to take an essay and make it into a song, how to make it into a rap, how to take poetry and then cultivate that into a song. So, you know, those were the things that, you know, I love to do. And again, it takes me back to connecting hip hop and, you know, education. Showing them how to get their ideas was here and was here on paper and then be able to find their voice within it and using, you know, again, music as that tool to find their voice and to find their peace and their mission.
Yeah. I think it's better that you did it with the two tape decks because that's
yeah.
That's the
old school, craft, that was old school way.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's the craft. Listen, that's so
absolutely.
Dope. That's how I absolutely. Started.
And,
that's how I started doing
bosses. And yeah. Yep. Wow. Mm-hmm. Wow. And as a gift, we used to do poetry every, I would have them do poetry. Like they would have to write a poem. Like once they would have to do a poem, like at least once a week. And then every morning when they came in, they had to do a critical lens, which I would give them like some kind of saying or you know, some kind of quote, and then they would have to relate it to either something that we read or, you know, just their life experience, so they can get, like, again, their ideas on paper and then start expressing themselves through written format. And with that, they started to love writing. And what I ended up doing was taking their poetry and actually creating a compilation for them at the end of the year as my gift to them. I binded it, took their poetry, and then it became their gift. And, you know, I was so inspired by it that I carry them in my briefcase everywhere I go. And so it's a little heavy because I did it for like several years, and I just wanted them to be able to see their growth, their social and emotional growth from when they started to where they ended, and then have something for them to reflect back on, like music. You know, when you listen to music, it creates the memories or connection to those memories that actually were created or that were happening during that time period. And that's the same thing I wanted to do for them. So this way they can look back and say, you know, yeah, I remember that time. That was a good time. That becomes a tool for them, a strategy for them when they're feeling angst, frustrated, or, you know, they want to go down memory lane. And no, again, those are things that I've learned, you know, through my course of time. And I felt like those might be things that would help empower them as well. And, you know, to this day, I'll hear them, you know, talk about, oh, yeah, I still got my book and that binder of stuff that you used to teach us. Wow. Or I have pictures, or, you know, I just wanted them to have a great experience, especially since, you know, they were the ones that, you know, they kind of pushed to the side, but they were able to beat the odds. And I think, again, hip hop helped them to realize what their goals and their dreams were, too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's so dope. People don't realize sometimes, they don't recognize how powerful hip hop can be.
Absolutely. Yeah. And that's why I created that curriculum where I talk about it from a sociology perspective and the connection to the African diaspora. And then we look at the, you know, the connections from the griot to the MC, to the drummer, to the DJ. Mm-hmm. And I mean, the writers and the hieroglyphics and the cuneiform and all those forms of writing, to the graph writers and the graffiti, to, you know, those that were dancing, expressing themselves through ritual and spiritual physical kinesthetics, to the break dances. All those things are evolutions to today, where we see remnants of it in the commercial part, but it still exists in the on the ground level, on the you know, at the root of it. Where you see the organized dances, where they're still there, whether you crunk, you call it getting hyped, whatever you call it, it is still that connection to, you know, to break dancing into the African diaspora. When you hear the rappers, a lot of times their message kind of gets lost because they don't have the foundation. So making that connection will turn them into having a platform that is positive, that will be, you know, uplifting and empowering for the people at the griot who went from village to village telling the story, and the MC who was, you know, giving you an idea or a glimpse into what they were living and how they were, their conditions of their environment, to, you know, again, the DJ who can change a room, a tune, a mood, a tone with just the drop of a needle. It's the same thing that we see, you know, at this level when you're at a club, or you're listening to it on digital or analog, that music, that playlist, you're able to now create a tone and a mood that you want to be involved in, so that you can find your way and that you can actually, again, find your peace, but also go down memory lane, use that as a strategy, you know? Yep. At my house, I put on shows every night. It's a good thing I live around family, because they would have called the cops on me, because all I do when I got downtime is want to karaoke.
Yes, that's what's up. Damn straight. Can't take the MC. You can't take the MC out. You can't.
Absolutely not. It is a vital part of the culture. It is the voice. It is the person that tells you what's going on. It is the leader in the sense of words, to make sure that you understand and you know what you got to do, where you got to go, what role you have to play. You know what I mean? It's almost, it becomes in a sense the commander of chief in chief, where the DJ and the drummer actually controls the vibe.
Yes.
It is the message from the, and the vocal of the MC that kind of gives you the direction of what to do and where to go. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? And you experience it through the body with the break dancing. You know what I mean? And written format, the graffiti, that is, again, the writings that tell you that this civilization existed and that it's still here and that we belong and that we have a voice and that we want to be seen, but we want to be respected at the same time.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, indeed. Woo!
Mm-hmm. Not for that.
Pint, my friend, I'm a fan. I've had the honor to do a video for you guys, to do music with you, collab with you, share the stage with you once. So, you know, it's been an honor. Thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you. And it's definitely a privilege, an honor. I'm humble, and I thank you guys for all the love. I thank you for having me on the platform. And again, anytime, just shout me out, let me know what you need, what you want. I got y'all. I appreciate y'all. And, you know, hopefully, you know, I'll have something coming out before the documentary so that this way you guys can have vibe to it and let me know what y'all think, because I appreciate everything that you guys did.
Well, my wife gave you some claps. By the way,
hi, Maura. How you doing?
shout out to Maura, because it was her idea. I mean, it was staring me in the face. Yeah, it was her idea. She's like, yeah, why don't you have Half Pint on the show? I'm like, oh.
Well, geez. Thank you.
Last week we were talking about who was coming up next, and she said, you know, the show is way too testosterone-y. Can somebody please call Half Pint?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Listen, anytime you need balance in the room, just call me. Just let me know.
Right? Because I'm kind of on my own here.
Listen, Jenny, what you got to do is just say, you know what, Pint, we need you. Put on the cape.
Yeah. Right? Yeah, there it is. Yep.
Girl, I'm coming for you because
there you go. It's rough I'll in be here like sometimes. This. I'll throw you the lifeline.
It gets rough that's in here up. Sometimes.
Yeah, yeah. Especially when So Chuckified's around.
Oh, God.
Listen. Listen, I know firsthand, again, being in a group with nothing but guys, it's a lot.
You think everybody's your big brother. I feel like I'm the den mother around here.
Yes, and I tell you, listen, it's not easy. You got to be able to stake your claim. You got to be able to stand your ground. It's not easy, because if not, they will make sure that they run over you. Not purposely, but it's just I think, like you said, it's the testosterone. They don't know any different. So you got to kind of, be that voice of reason and that even keel to say, listen, we're in the house. We're here too. We have a voice.
Yep. Yeah. Listen, there comes a point where I want to go, don't make me come over there. Don't you make me come back there.
Yeah. It's probably a good thing you're on the West Coast, so.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Yes. It is probably a very good thing.
Well, yeah, it's dope. It's dope to have you here, Pint, and it will have you back another time. I also saw Wisdom Beats was in the chat. He says he's got beats, and you know I got beats for you, so we'll figure it out. We'll get it going.
Yes, indeed.
Yes, yeah. Ma'am.
I'll add a sister. I'm here.
Okay. Thanks, wonderful. Pint.
I definitely appreciate y'all. Salute. Double salute. Love y'all. Thank you. Peace.
Take care. Peace. All right. Well, there it is. Wow, that was like
just was fantastic.
Like, yeah. It was just I don't even know where to start. That was amazing.
She is great. She is great.
Yeah, yep.
Incredible. Yep. So many gems and jewels dropped there that it's,
right.
So inspirational. She's wonderful.
Yep. Seriously. Yeah. Seriously dope.
Yeah.
And yes. And like the wife says, yes. Yes, indeed, hon.
Yeah.
I agree.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And a dope MC as well.
And a dope MC as well. Yep.
Yep.
And nobody pointed out, but probably the only hype chick in hip hop.
Yeah. Yep.
The one and only. Mm-hmm. Name another one.
I was trying to think of one, but I can't. I don't think there is one.
I think you're right.
Because there really isn't one.
Flavor Flav?
Female.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Oh, man. We lost Jennifer and Jenny again.
Name another female hype chick.
I think you're right. I had thought about it earlier, you know, her being, you know, the, especially on the first album, you know, she actually got to MC on Well Thought Out, but on the first album she is the, you know, she's the hype role. And
there's nobody else.
Wow.
Not another one.
That's weird that there's there's a blueprint right there and nobody followed that, huh?
It, right. Well, and not only that, but she comes from, I mean, you know, she didn't want to throw any shade. Nobody wanted to throw any shade. I'll throw some damn shade. Because she comes from a time, everybody she named, Pebbly Poo, Latifah, Light, yep, blah, 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 blah. These people, being the odd female in hip hop, they were still classy as hell.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep.
Now.
And nasty. Nasty on the mic, too. Because right. they had to be.
They had, you know, to be, because otherwise nobody would take them seriously.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yep. Exactly.
And now?
Yeah.
You show your ass and show you us make a record. Money and you're good.
Yeah. Yeah. That's it. Very true.
Yeah. It makes Foxy Brown and Lil' Kim look tame in comparison.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. But here's the frightening thing. How can you make, and you're going to know exactly who I'm talking about when I say this, because I'm not even going to say her name, but how can you make a song that you refuse to let your own children listen to?
Yeah.
But yet everybody else's children are still running around talking about.
Yeah, and look, I get making adult music for adults. I understand that. But we're talking about pop stars here.
But there's a line that has been crossed massively.
Totally.
Yeah.
Massively. Let Latifah go up on stage and talk about WAP. Are you seriously? Latifah would be like, "You want me to say what?"
Yeah. Did she knock him out?
You want me to do what? Who am I? What is this? Two Live Crew? No.
You want me to be derogatory towards Italians? What? WAP? I'm part Italian. I can say that.
Yeah. So. Just, lost her again. Know, but... No. She's gone again. No.
Because ask Latifah or Light to do something like that.
Right. They won't.
It wouldn't happen.
It wouldn't happen. Uh-uh. Nope. Very true.
Or Half Pint. Ask her.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yep. Never happened. Not a chance in hell.
There's a huge, huge line that has been crossed. And so anything that people like, anybody... Anything that Latifah, Light, Half Pint, any of these women did means nothing now.
Yeah.
Means absolutely nothing.
Yep.
Got it.
Never forget. Sad state of affairs.
What are we never forgetting?
What they did. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Latifah did ladies first.
Yeah.
Okay. And are these ones ladies? Can we refer to them as?
Yep.
Flatline. Settle down. I said I was going to throw some shade.
Throw it.
You're talking to somebody who I was at K-Day. Yeah, right. I was at K-Day in 84. And like the most saucy thing that would have happened would have been like the cover of Ice-T's Power album.
Yeah.
But, and that was like really the only female, you know, that was, and granted, she wasn't even on the album, but that was the mood at that point. And then all of a sudden, Latifah and Light and all of these people break into it. And it's something completely different. And these are females who cannot be messed with.
Yeah.
Right.
Yep.
They just can't.
And also remember too, that was also a period, a time where those different perspectives could exist alongside each other as well.
Right. That's also
because it was really hip hop against the world.
Yeah.
Right.
At that point.
And, you know, there were people like Luke Skywalker and Two Live Crew and all of that kind of stuff that was, you know, still throwing it into that, whatever you want to call it. but those female MCs worked so hard.
Yeah.
And then, you know, and then you get people who are out there now. And what are they doing?
Yeah.
Besides completely shitting on everything they did.
Remember, pop, we're talking about pop stars, Jen. We're true. Talking about pop true. Stars.
True.
Anything to sell but, a record. They might rap, but, you know, they're pop stars.
Yeah. Yeah.
I know. I know it's tough, but people got to remember that.
But if you say, you know, who's your favorite female rapper? How many people are going to say Cardi B?
Yeah. Whoever the flavor of the month is.
Or
right?
Megan Thee Stallion.
Did Cardi B retire? Didn't one of them retire?
Oh, really?
I hope so. I don't know.
but they've been replaced by, what's her name? Lotto.
I don't know. Yes, Jason, Nicki Minaj is a pop star.
Yeah.
She makes pop records. Mm-hmm. She could spit, but, you know, even if you think she can spit, she's still a pop star. Eminem's a pop star. He makes pop records.
Oh no! Here now we're going down that rabbit hole.
No, Eminem. I don't know. No, I'm just saying because you know he's making calculated. All his records that he makes that they make are to be played on radio. You know they got to have a radio single. That's I'm just saying that's what it is. That's all. There's nothing wrong with it.
But
that's what it is.
So in that case, if that's your criteria for a pop star, there wasn't really a rap group that didn't put out a radio version of anything.
Yeah, well, remember that the audience, yeah, back in the day, you know, there was rap radio and then there was pop radio. And occasionally it would cross over. Hammer cross over.
Young MC
would cross over and stuff like that. But that was still very minimal. It wasn't, it took a while. It probably wasn't until, what, Puffy? Yeah. And Puffy in late 90s, that's when they started making rap records for pop radio. They were specifically making rap records for Puff.
Take him out. Is that what's going on here?
No, we just only if we could go back in time, maybe. Doesn't matter now. Now he just makes Instagram videos where he dances around his driveway, you know.
Oh man.
What about Wild Thing and Funky Cold Medina? That was Tone Loc.
It was Tone Loc. Those were records
but
that
those
got
were also written by Young MC.
Yeah. But again, those were records that kind of, but still, okay, for example, right? I'm growing up in Pittsburgh. We had, like, I guess what was B94 was the pop radio station, right? And then there was Whammo, which was the black music station. And
Whammo?
WAMO is one of the oldest, it was one of the oldest black owned stations in the country. And, but it even took Whammo a long time to start playing rap records. Even early on, they weren't playing it. So even like a record like Funky Cold Medina, when it came out, B94 wasn't playing that shit. In fact, remember when all the radio stations, like the pop stations would be like, you know, all the hits and no rap. No, that's what they would say.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right.
For a long time.
And then you came to K-Day and it was like, what? That's all they do?
And it's all rap.
What's going on there?
Yep.
You mean you don't want to play Prince? Yeah, we do. But he's just going to be shoved in between the Fat Boys and Run DMC. It'll be fine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep. So, yep. It was a different time. It was a different time. There were crossover records. In fact, speaking of Whammo, they had when You Can't Touch This came out, one of the DJs did a mashup mix of You Can't Touch This and Super Freak that is still, I remember, one of the dopest things I ever heard, man. Wow, that was crazy good. Yeah. I had it on a cassette for years, and I don't know if I still do or not, or where that cassette is, but man, it was, I will never forget that. It was so dope. So,
did you see what Chuck said?
Yeah, there you go. Yep. Yep, Pittsburgh's Melly Mel. That's right. Melly Mel Plowden. May he rest in peace. Yep. Yeah.
Yes, sir. K-Day in Los Angeles.
Yep.
1580 KDAY.
Got a shout. Another shout out to PE for. There we go. Mr. Chuck knows. Because Chuck was always good about shouting out rap radio back in the day. You know, always good about that in the liner notes. And in fact, let me grab something.
He just left.
We'll just talk amongst ourselves.
I'm done, right? Okay. It's fluffy chat.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
These were the ones on the back. I know you can't read it, but the Rap Control DJs, they listed it.
Right, that's right.
Yep.
Wow.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, that's really, really cool.
Yeah. So.
He's still doing it.
Oh, yeah. He's got them all, man.
He's running a list.
Yep. He knows. Yep. He got them. So, yeah. I always thought that was dope.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know when.
Right, K-Day was not alone, but.
But you guys were the big one. One of the big ones.
We were the biggest. We were the biggest, and yeah. I'm gonna say that we were probably the first to go pretty much all, you know, we were still considered very much a black radio station, but it went very quickly from being nobody like Luther Vandross and whoever, Prince, Michael Jackson, you know, to then being mostly rap. I would say probably even like 84, our playlist went very quickly from majority R&B to the majority rap.
Wow.
It went very quickly.
That's crazy.
Very quickly.
Yeah.
Yeah. But that was back in 84.
Yeah.
Early. And like there wasn't that many records to be playing then.
No. Right. No.
Yeah.
I can remember 84.
When did you start there?
84.
You started in 84? Mm-hmm. So they were still playing R&B records when you started.
Yeah. I may have even been there as early as 83.
Okay.
Like the end of 83. But yeah, exactly, Jason Catalano. It went from Barry White into the Fat Boys. You know, it wasn't... I'd have to look back, but I know that on, like, if I Google search, I can find old playlists from K-Day. And... Yeah. And I'm sure that the majority of them, Lonzo, you can go that far back and still see it be like the majority rap. He's talking about Lonzo, exactly, Bataram. Yep. Lonzo is the Wrecking Crew, where Dr. Dre came from, and Yella came from.
Yep.
You know, the Wrecking Crew. We had the LA Dream Team. Okay, yeah. Chuck, let's really go back. LA Dream Team, Egyptian Lover, Arabian Prince.
Yep.
Uncle Jam's Army was a big thing. And we even had at the radio station, Russ Parr was one of our DJs. Russ Parr was Bobby Jimmy of Bobby Jimmy and the Critters.
Yep.
And you know who else was a critter? Arabian Prince.
Arabian Prince. I never realized until many years later, because my cousin John got...
Oh, no, not Macola.
Yeah.
Holy crap.
But my cousin John got a hold of the New York LA Rappers by Bobby Jimmy and the Critters. And we just used to laugh our asses off at that. And I didn't find out till years later that Dre produced that song.
Yeah. Russ Parr was everybody's answer to Weird Al Yankovic. Really.
Yes. Yep.
He was hip hop's. Yeah. Yep. He was hip hop's answer to Weird Al.
Yeah. Yep. Roaches. But
yeah, exactly. See, she's got a big butt.
Yep.
Yeah.
Great stuff.
But, you know, way back then, yep, Dre made all those swap meet tapes. Exactly.
Yeah.
NW. Yep. NWA all had clocks. I remember when, I mean, because we're talking about NWA was made up of majority of guys from the World Class Wrecking Crew and guys who were usually around the radio station all the time.
Right.
So I can remember the first time I, you know, Dre and Yella and Arabian are making this new rap group. Really? What are they called? NWA. What? What does that mean? And I heard and was like, really? It's like, wait a minute. Exactly. Wait a minute. Yep. Are these the same guys that I'm not understanding this. yeah, Roger Clayton. Exactly. Roger Clayton. Mm-hmm. Yep. It, Uncle Jam's Army. They were a huge, huge. You could not go to an Uncle Jam's Army party, and there would be a line. Exactly, clear around the block.
Yeah.
Clear around the block. Later, Greg Mack. Yep. Well, Greg Bashan's Mack. Chuck.
Bashan's mom went to school with Roger Clayton.
Yeah. Greg Mack is what turned, is who turned K-Day into the rap radio station.
Mm.
That was all Greg Mack. That was all his doing.
Wow.
But yeah, I'd have to say that 84 started the deep dive into K-Day turning pretty much all rap.
Yeah, that's crazy. Because like I said, Pittsburgh, it didn't happen till 89.
Yeah, see, but I remember it.
There was little bits of songs like, you know, they probably play Run DMC or something like that, but like they weren't playing, not until I remember clearly when I was sitting in the car, we stopped at this ice cream spot, and I'm sitting in the car, Whammo's on, and the DJ's like, when we come back from the break, we're going to play the new single from Spike Lee's movie, Do the Right Thing by Public Enemy, Fight the Power. And I was like bugging out because I'm like, what? You guys are going to play Public Enemy? And there's a new Public Enemy song? And then my mom shut the car off and like went to get the ice cream. I'm like, Mom, what are you doing? You know, and turned it back on. And it was like the song had already started, but I just like bugging out. That was the first time I heard Fight the Power.
Wow.
I can remember. I can remember Melly Mel, Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five showing up at the radio station. I can remember Houdini back when. With their first, you know, Fat Boys. I remember the Fat Boys coming in. So that was a long, long, long time ago.
Yeah.
And I also remember very much that, holy cow, Chuck, J.J. Johnson. Yes. You know that J.J. Johnson was the DJ, the one DJ at K-Day that had been there the longest. And little trivia, in case nobody knew, Wolfman Jack was on K-Day at one point.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Wow. Yeah, Wolfman Jack was on K-Day for a while. But J.J. Johnson had been there absolutely the longest, and he got to close the radio station out. He got to say the final.
That's awesome.
I was like, they better have given it to him.
Right?
He got to sign the damn thing off.
That's awesome. That's dope.
Even though he fought for it to be all rap, he did not want to go down that alley. But he fought tooth and nail. He was like, oh, God, do we have to?
He didn't want it to be all rap? Mm-mm. Wow.
Mm-mm.
I guess he came around.
Yeah, he did. It Chuck says he played Fight the Power. Yeah. He kind of, you know. But at the very beginning, I can still remember... at the very beginning of my being at the radio station, I started in the public affairs department, and we always went out to high schools and we did dances on the weekends and we did whatever. Yes, he was a soul man, that J.J. Johnson. We love you, J.J. And I can remember, like, Candyman was part of our group in the public affairs department. These were the people that we took around.
What was this? Candyman? Knocking Boots?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Candyman. Coolio.
Ah.
Before
the Mad Circle?
And I can think of 8 million others, but the one that always stuck out in my head was Jennifer so-and-so can't show up. Can you call Ice-T? And he would always show up. You know, and that was always the case. And even in 84, we're talking about... LA Dream Team and Egyptian Lover and all of those kinds of guys were very, very, very much in existence. World Class Wrecking Crew, very much in existence.
Yep.
You
know what I think is one of the great tragedies in hip hop, that we never got a second low profile album.
Yeah. I agree.
Okay. I'm serious.
Yes. Rest in peace, good. General Jeff. Yes.
Yeah. So rest sad. In peace, General Jeff. Yep.
So indeed. Sad.
Yep. But yo, I call WC, call out. Aladdin, tell him to make another low profile album.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I'll get right on that.
Do that for me. Thanks.
Sure. I'll get right on that.
Yeah. Thanks. Tell him to make it just, you know, say, okay, guys, pretend it's 89, and you got to do the follow-up. So.
Right, yeah.
And they'll be like, I'm sorry, C-Doc, who the fuck are you?
Yeah, Skateland Red, World on Wheels Blue. And let me tell you, holy cow, how do you remember all of that, Chuck? I'll never forget taking LL Cool J to Skateland. And saying to him before we even got there, do not, under any circumstances, and it wasn't even Skateland, it was World on Wheels, do not under any circumstances, you know what, just don't wear red or blue. Don't wear all the gold. Don't, just don't. And what do you suppose he did?
Showed up in
head to toe red.
Yep.
Every piece of gold he could find, red Kangol, red. Like, seriously, you want us to get killed? You just want to take all of us out? Yeah. Yeah, General Jeff.
No, General Jeff did do the best drop for "And You Don't Stop." That's very true.
Did he?
Yeah. It's I'm not going to try to do it, but his voice is just so great.
I did have the honor of meeting General Jeff once. So.
Oh,
yeah.
I knew General Jeff very, 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 very well.
I'm sure.
And it really bothered me.
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you what, this has been a hell of a show. Not only did we get the half pint schooling, but Jen and Chuck D just took us back. A lot of radio history there. Wow.
Yeah. It's great. Mm-hmm. All great.
Yeah. At Skateland, you did not say cuz.
Yeah. Yeah. Dow Jones, too. Yep.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Crazy.
General Jeff, Jason, for General Jeff. Oh, shoot. How did General Jeff get? General Jeff was part of Uncle Jam's army, I believe.
I think so.
He was also part of Bobby, Jimmy, and the Critters. He was also part of Rodney O and Joe Cooley.
Sure was.
Is
C Doc getting up to get his copy of Rodney O and Joe Cooley? Because I was about to. No.
Go ahead. I'm queuing up music to take us out on.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yeah. He was part of Rodney O and Joe Cooley. But yeah, Rodney was just not Rodney. Jeff was just a really, really great guy. I cannot say enough about Jeff.
Yep. I met him.
Was pretty freaking amazing. Yes. Mayor of Skid Row. Yep.
Yes. That's when I got to meet him because he organized that benefit show. I was there to film some of it with Chuck and crew. Yep.
I found it.
You got it? Yes.
There he is.
There
he is, Mr. General Jeff. And yes, we just lost him.
Yep.
Yeah.
Everlasting peace.
Like so three good. Or 4 months ago.
Yeah, it wasn't that long.
Mm-mm.
Wasn't that long.
Nope. Very sad.
Yeah. Yep. Rest in peace, General Jeff. Gang, do we know who we have on the show next week? Because I don't remember.
No, we do not.
Oh, okay. That's why I don't remember.
Exactly.
Huh.
Because nobody knows.
Well, then we'll have to figure it out. But we will be back next week for another episode of It's C-Doc again. It's been fun.
I hope M-Rock comes back. Is he not showing up because I'm here? Is that what it is?
Yeah, he was like, I was like, hey, Flatline's going to be on. He's like, fuck that guy. he got stuck at work again, I guess. So
after Daddy-O said he wanted to marry him, I'm out.
Yeah.
Shout out to M-Rock.
Shout out to M-Rock. Yep. Shout out to So Chuckified, who's out there.
Shout out to Jason in the comments there.
Yep. Yeah. Shout out, Jason.
Yep. Shout out. Who else can we shout out? Shout out to Mr. Chuck.
Shout out Mr. Chuck. Shout out Professor Griff.
Oh, yeah, Professor Griff.
Yep.
He was shout here.
Half pint.
Yeah. Shout out to Jim, Half Pint.
Seriously.
Yeah.
Amazing. Jawel, Bazerk, all those guys.
Yep.
And Mora for suggesting it.
Yes. Shout out to Mrs. Snyder.
It's the most important shout out of them all.
Yep. Exactly. Damn straight. Shout out Vashon. Good to see you here, bro.
Anybody else? Always. Hype Style, Jason.
Yeah, always shout out to Hype Style.
Yep.
Damn straight. Shout out to Jennifer O'Jenny for wearing her Yagfu shirt. Yeah.
We're busted looping it.
But Sean, anytime you want to, man, just let me know. As long as it's not Tuesday nights when I got to do my show, unless we're going to do like the mad team up, we could try that. That might be interesting. It might be a disaster, but it'd be fun, you know? Shout out to Flatline for being the guest host again.
Whoa.
You're going to be back next week? You'll be with us?
Maybe.
I'm giving you a whole week to come up with a question.
Like, I don't know. It depends on who's going to be there.
I work better under pressure. So, yeah, I'll just
okay.
come up That's with some cool questions like a half hour before.
That's
so, cool. Yeah, if you need me to come back, I'll come back. It's a pleasure. I just kind of sit here and kind of soak it all up. I'm just, like, enjoying every minute. So
especially when Chuck shows up. That's all I do. He makes my job easy, man. He's just, like, he's got the great questions. So I don't know why he didn't just take over the show.
You know? It's Chuck D again.
It's Chuck D
because again. Then it's not C Doc again.
Yeah, I know, but I get like, you know, I could just press start.
You could like switch off one week on, 1 week off.
Exactly.
Yeah.
There you go. But thanks to everybody in the chat, and thanks to everybody watching us on the replay. As always. And again, Chuck missed. Yeah, I know. We'll bring school. I told Schooly he'd come back when his album drops. So,
yeah,
you know, you'll be on that one. That'll be fun. You and Schooly.
Oh,
that'll be good. You're amazing.
Yep. You already know.
Yeah.
You already know how much fun that's going to be.
Oh, my goodness. You even missed Joe Fatal, Chuck. What the heck?
Joe Fatal was great.
That's a high water mark.
Yes.
Props, shout out to Joe Fatal. Wow. Yeah.
Yep.
It will be crazy. Indeed.
Yep.
Indeed.
All right, folks.
All right, everybody. Taking us out.
See ya.
Little change style. Yo, Weebly, and the change style.
Let's take it to the stage, you suckers. There's that voice. I'm the son of a bad dance. The suckers can't deal with it. Straight up to the hit of it. Yo, dig it, we're doing. And I'll let you know I'm digging you. Basically, we'll swing with the hit. Coming from the brick. Me on another brother tip. Ain't none of that. Down like an elevator. You know I got to make it feel funky for you. Yo, it's the beat that we're rolling with. What show no pity for? Put the fake in the funk. Reach me the mic and I'll recite. And I'm not the herb or the one to be tested. Take my advice, brother. I suggest. Yes. The second, the mic. Well done, Flatline. Look how young they were.
So young.
Can you feel it? Word. Oh my God. This new way to sway. That's okay.
Yes. You know what's funny about this record?
Chuck says he did a track with Joe Fatal.
Let me tell you something funny about this record is that the labels are wrong. Side one is side two, and side two is side one. Yeah. Because I put it on once. I was like, hey, what the hell?
Yeah, that's not correct.
Yeah, that's not right. But that's all right. Still nice to have it. Anyway, all right, everybody. Peace out. If I can remember how to turn the show off.
Oh, just keep dancing.
Yeah, keep dancing. Put a brother down, suck a bit world renowned. Yo, that captain said he's a hill mother. Shut up! I said shut up! Born and raised on a one-way street. And you can bear witness that we're tearing it up. You know you bust the sound, the ill freak movement. This hit here, put it on the air. Rhyme on a coaster, cold like a hole. Nobody moves, nobody gets hurt. Try and set me and I'll smoke you. Hit the microphone cord, straight up choke you.
Oh, there's that fight in the comments. Oh, man. I don't have that.
That's what I'm playing right now.
Absolutely half pint.
Yeah.
Much love to half pint. You know what I kick, you don't dig in, I'm cooling, I'm swaying, I keep saying. I'm rolling like a lion, the rhyme need a bag of ice. I'm on fire, sit down, be my people, and shoot at my structure. I emphasize the dialogue, please, nothing, you become inferior. You grow weary, run up a scratch, I put my hand on my tooth, and boom. The technique, smoke from your eardrum, you will say the son of Bazerk. Change the style! Get wild! We'll be right back.
It's C-Doc again.